Hey, thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. We have prayed that you'd be blessed by it. We want you to know, too, we believe that this is really supplemental to your experience in the life of a local church. But if you're here in the Dallas area, we hope you'll come and join us and be with us for worship. We pray this blesses your life and you're drawn closer to Christ as a result of this message.
Because you know this is true. See, our mission is really the same. We say it often, Pastor Carter and I. We have just two churches, just different locations. In fact, we have churches all across the world that are worshiping the Lord today in every tribe, every nation, all colors, whatever color you are, all people around the gospel, we're all one because there's something greater that unites us.
That you and I have to make sure we cultivate relationships across racial lines. If we only stay with the group that makes us most comfortable, then we'll miss the joy of watching the gospel work in all of our lives. No one can do what God did for us, and He did it because of grace. We are just incredibly excited and honored to join together again in this year's Pulpit Swap, Pulpit Exchange. It's a joy, and we are incredibly grateful for Pastor Jeff and the Park City's family for just these. This is our third season doing it, and we're thankful for how God has continued to connect our hearts together and to serve together in this city. Your pastor and I have been together so many times. It's amazing to consider that what started with a lunch together, talking about some of the challenges around race in our city, begin to grow. And so we begin to do that first year where we exchanged pulpits, and then the next year, last year, we had about 16 churches that did it together, and now some 24, 25 churches. And so we are thankful for how the Lord continues to move, because we just believe the church plays a crucial role in helping to deal with matters of race, but also to communicate unity. We just believe that the church can do more together than it ever can do apart. And so we are grateful indeed for this friendship, this partnership, and we thank the Lord for these music ministries sharing together. Can you help me to celebrate them for their ministry? Amen, amen. So we are thankful to them. I know our church is in for a treat today, as they love hearing your pastor, and it is my honor to stand in my friend's stead today, and I am grateful for him in many, many ways. I want to invite your attention this morning to the book of 1 John chapter 4, the book of 1 John chapter 4. I'll read a few verses out of that particular book, 1 John chapter 4. We want to get down to verse 7. And so as usual, sometimes we are from the southern Dallas, and we're thankful to be up in North Dallas today. But I need your help. In our tradition, in African American tradition, there's something called call and response. It's where I say something and you talk back to me, or you say amen, or you say preach, preacher. And so I want to encourage you to support me today, and we can make me feel like I'm at home, all right? And Jeff is getting a lot of support today. They're interrupting him the whole sermon, but he's getting used to it. But we are grateful indeed. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 says it this way. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. And anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And in this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. For a few moments, using this passage for our time today, I want to talk about love, the antidote to racism. Love, the antidote to racism. For spring break, just a couple of weeks ago, my family and I loaded up in the car, and we took our road trip. This particular road trip, we had been talking about doing this trip, a little civil rights trip, for some time. And so we loaded up the car and we made our way. We made a couple of stops in this trip. The first stop we made was there in Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. It was there where integration took place in 1957. And we spent time there learning and visiting the museum, looking at the high school and learning about the experience there. And then after visiting there at Little Rock High School, Central High, we then got back in the car for 2 more hours and then drove to Memphis. We drove to Memphis there and stayed at the Peabody Hotel. And then next morning, got up and went to the Lorraine Motel, the Civil Rights Institute there. We went there to the very place where Dr. King had been assassinated there in 1968 and began to watch the story of race, of the black, of African Americans throughout their heritage. And then we went from Little Rock, and then we traveled to Memphis, and then leaving Memphis, we then got in our car again and drove some other 3 hours to Birmingham, Alabama. And there we went to the 16th Street Church, and there we were able to see the park where many things took place. And we began to spend our few days there thinking about the history of African Americans in our city, and thinking about the impact and the story of race as it has played such an important part of the fabric of our nation. And we begin to think about we had so many discussions and conversations as we learned and talked about all these different challenges that have been along the way. But if we thought about the challenges that we face, we also were reminded that despite the long racial history that we've had, there's also been a long line of courageous individuals, people, workers, who have fought against injustice and who have fought for equality and who have fought to eliminate racism. William Wilberforce and Richard Allen and Thurgood Marshall and Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King, many individuals that stood strong against racism in these difficult times. And as we begin to think about that, the thing about all of those individuals, that often the reason, the thing that motivated them the most was their faith in Jesus Christ. They didn't stand up just by accident or just because they thought it was the popular thing to do. At the core of what motivated them to get involved and get engaged was their love for God and their love for Christ and their love for people. Matter of fact, Jesus was once asked by a scribe, what is the greatest commandment? He said, when you look at all of Scripture, what's the most important? When I look at all of these some 600 commands, what's most important? And Jesus would come back and say to him, the most important one is that you ought to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And the second is like it, you ought to love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, if you could sum up all the Scripture, you could sum it up in those two parts, love God and love others. And that's why I believe that truly, if racism is ever to be addressed, if racism is ever to be lessened in our community, this ugly issue that although it may change forms, continues to exist, that it's only going to be addressed by the people of God learning how to live and love one another as God has set before us. This passage in 1 John chapter 4, the apostle of John, he writes to God's people, and he says, I want you to love others. He says, something happens when you love other people. And there's three things I want to lift up from this passage. First of all, we ought to love others because it is evidence of our love for God. We ought to love others because it's evidence of our love for God. It's right there in verse 7 where he says to them, for love comes from God. Here is the apostle John, who was one of Jesus' disciples. He walked and ministered with Jesus Christ. And now as he writes this letter to the believers, he says, I want you to love one another. I mean, you would think that if you are a follower of Christ, does someone have to tell you to love one another? But just like us, sometimes we can forget. Because the truth of the matter is, in our natural lives, we can be very selfish and self-absorbed. In our natural lives, we can be very focused upon what we want and what we desire and how we want it and when we want it and the way that we want it. But here comes John saying, let us love one another. And when he uses this word love in the text, it is that Greek word agape. Friends, you understand that in our world, we have one word for love. But in their world, there were three distinct words that represented love. There was phileo, which was a friendship, eros, which was a romantic, sensual love. But then there was agape, which was the highest level of love that could ever exist. And he comes and he says, I want you to love one another. He says, because when you love one another, it is an indication that you've been born of God. He says that your love for others, your love for people that are different than a skin color, different parts of the city, different socioeconomic status, he says your love for others should communicate that you belong to God, that you have been born of God. He says when we're born of the flesh, we're born focused on ourselves. But when we are born of God, we are born to focus on loving others. Can you imagine a firefighter showing up to fight a fire without his uniform on? Could you imagine that firefighter showing up with shorts and a t-shirt on, talking about he's ready to put out the fire? They would look at him like something was wrong, because they understand that if you're going to fight fires, you must have on your uniform. You must have on the protective gear and the helmet so that you can in turn be prepared to fight the fire for what you've been called to do. And in many respects, friend, every believer, you have a uniform as well that you cannot afford not to wear. And the uniform is the uniform of love. Every day you wake up, you've got to put on that uniform of love, because it proves that you belong to God's family. It proves that you've experienced God's love, and you can't help but to express that love to other people. He says it proves we've been born of God. I have two older brothers, and there are some similarities in us. We are both, all of us, around the same height. All of us have a similar built. All of us have the same round head. It's called a peanut Carter head. And we if you sit from the back, you can recognize us, because our heads all are shaped the same. And so we have some similarities, because it's in our DNA. It's in our DNA. We've come from the same mother and father. It's a part of who we are, and it shows up in our very lives. And likewise, because you've been born of God, because we share the same Heavenly Father, love is in the DNA of your life. It's in how you live. It's in how you act, because you've been born of God. That's what he says. Matter of fact, he says if love doesn't show up in our lives, it means that we weren't born of God. He says, matter of fact, he says God is love. And friends, that's not a cliche. That is the very doctrine of the truth of who God is and how God has rewired. Matter of fact, this whole ideal of love is so important to God that God mentions it over and over again. Jesus would say to them, I give you a new commandment, that you would love one another. In the New Testament, there are these one another commands. Confess to one another, love one another, bear with one another. There are 52 of these one another commands. It's almost as though God says, I'm going to give you 52 commandments, 52 one another commands, one for every week of the year, so that you can remember that love is not just what you do, love is who we are. You ought to love. We have to love, because it proves, it's evidence that we've been born of God. But secondly, we ought to love others by imitating God's love for us. We ought to love others by imitating God's love for us. Verse 9 says this. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. And this is the love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us. And he sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Loving others is our opportunity to imitate God. It's our privilege. If we're going to love one another, it's the very opportunity for us to imitate God. It's the way that we live. When we look for a picture of what love looks like, we have to look no further than the picture of what God did when he sent his Son to die on the cross for our sins. It's the picture of what love looks like. So when we love each other, all we do is we imitate what God did for us as believers in Christ. This is what he did. He showed his love to us. He sent his only Son. There are several ideas that we learn about love from this passage. We learn that love initiates. Because the scripture says that God sent his son. That love is not passive or dormant, but that love is responsive. Love initiates. Love, it doesn't just sit out. But God saw the brokenness of our lives, saw the brokenness of sin, saw the depravity of our lives, sent his son to die for us. That's what love looks like. Love doesn't just look at something, but love gets involved. Love initiates. Love moves. Love is a verb, but love not only initiates, but love also sacrifices. This is what God did for us. He didn't just say that I see you and I pray that things will get better. No, but what God does is that God not only does he initiate, but he sacrifices his son. He gives his one and only son as the perfect once for all sacrifice to die on the cross. Love sacrifice. Jesus would say it this way. No greater love does a man have than to lay down his life for another. Love sacrifices. Love initiates. Love sacrifices. But also love transforms. Because the scriptures say that when he, not only would he sacrifice, not only would he become the not only would he satisfy the wrath of God, but we would be transformed by the love of God. God's love for us transforms us so that we no longer are the old creation, but now every man and woman has been made new. We've been transformed by his love. We no longer have the same desires. We no longer have the same destination. We no longer have the same appetites. We no longer know who we used to be. We are new in Christ because his love transforms us. But also this, love also chooses, because love is a choice. He didn't, the scripture says that Christ laid down his life. God says that he sent his son. It's a choice. Love doesn't come automatically, because automatically we think about ourselves before we think about others. But love is a choice. Love is to choose to love someone. Love is to be intentional in my actions to make sure I am cultivated and connecting with someone else. Love ultimately is to put someone else's needs before my own. This very day that we're here today because of a relationship that God has allowed myself and Pastor Jeff to cultivate, because of our love for each other and our love for Christ and our love for the church. And Pastor Jeff didn't have to, but he was kind enough to enter and to connect and to build a relationship. And so when we begin this time together around 2 to 3 years ago, when Ferguson and Trayvon Martin and all these issues are happening, it's a love for one another that Pastor Jeff was willing to sit down and we begin to talk. But what does this mean what does this mean for us? Because we love one another and love the church and love the work. What does this mean? And how do we as a church get involved around this? And so we begin to host round tables of pastors. He would bring 8 white pastors, I'd bring 8 black pastors. We would sit down around tables, we'd have lunch together, and we'd begin to have some tough conversations about what does it feel like when you get pulled over by the, what does it feel like to have grown up in the culture that you have? What does it feel like? What has life been like for you? Because we love one another. We've been able to enter each other's worlds and to try to understand and to try to figure this thing out. And that's what love is. Love is being willing to be empathetic and understanding, and not to excuse somebody's story, but to try to understand somebody's story. And understand that we really deeply need each other. That it's not just Southern Dallas needing North Dallas, but North Dallas needs Southern Dallas. We all need each other. And this only is lived out through love. But if love is the motivation, if love is the common currency that we share in our lives, then and only then can it happen. When we talk about this matter of race, so the past few years, Pastor Jeff and I have been in different settings talking and sharing and trying to understand. We were in Charleston for the first year anniversary of the Emmanuel 9. They're visiting with survivors of this tragedy and trying to understand how do we continue to work in this area. And one of the questions that has continually surfaced is, What can we do? What can we do? And I believe that the call for the church is to understand that there are still matters of racial injustice that the church has to be engaged in, but not just the church, but even me and my own personal life, my own personal influence. There are three, at least three major areas of racial injustice that continue to show up today. One of those areas is in criminal justice. Bryan Stevenson, in his book, Just Mercy, and Anna Ava DuVernay in her documentary, 13th, both of them do an excellent job of shining the light on the continual issues of how the criminal justice system is slanted against people of color. Mass incarceration continues to be one of the greatest issues of social injustice of today. America has only 5% of the world's population and 25% of the world's incarcerated. 1 in 17 white males, 1 in 6 Hispanic males, and 1 in 3 black males can be expected to go to prison or jail at some point in their lives. Black men make up 6.5% of U.S. population, but 40% of the prison population. Texas is spending on prison and jails is the highest in the nation, and it's grown 5 times faster than the state's rate of spending on elementary and secondary education. When communities are blighted and neglected, and economically and educationally, then automatically that poverty and criminal activity leads to this issue of mass incarceration. So this is an issue that we have to be engaged in. And your church is already engaged in, but it's an issue that we have to be aware of, that there are aspects of the criminal justice system that disproportionately target those of color. Several things that can be done. Prevention can be done. When we advocate for mentoring and tutoring and quality education, we can be involved in prison ministry where we go in and show love to those that are incarcerated to make sure that the church has not forgotten about them. We can be involved in reentry programs like in your church where we help individuals that are coming out of incarceration to find jobs, to find housing, to find mentoring, to find job training. And then we can even advocate for criminal justice reform. And we can begin to look for policy changes so that we can begin to stem the tide of this ongoing issue. Criminal justice, it's a place, it's a space where there continues to be these racial inequities. But not only criminal justice, but also economically. Dallas has the 4th highest poverty rate in the country. In 2012, 1 in 4 Dallas residents lived in poverty. That's a family of 4 making around $24,000 a year. And the poor, typically black or Hispanic, did not finish high school, young, have children, not working or working part-time or seasonal jobs. With such a strong and vibrant business community in Dallas, surely, with a global reputation, surely we can continue to address the racial, the economic divide in our community. We can do that in so many ways, whether it's job creation or entrepreneurship or economic partnerships or economic development or mentorships or access to capital. There are so many ways that we must make it the responsibility of the believers to make sure that we are looking for ways to connect and provide opportunities for those individuals that come from those underrepresented communities. It's exposing children and youth so that they know what the limits and what the opportunities are in your life. And your church continues to model that, whether it was the recent fair that you had for individuals' immigrant backgrounds, helping them to figure out how to navigate through the resources that are available. But it's so important because economically, as long as we're not those that have influence, ought to be leveraging the influence to try and help provide a sense of how do we build up, how do we give the infrastructure so that we can continue to have prosperity both north and south of the Trinity. It must happen around criminal justice, not only economically, but then finally educationally. In our city, just like most inner cities, those schools are the schools that need the most support. Those schools have often been marginalized by various structures, and yet we need infrastructure. It could be mentoring. It could be volunteering at a school. It could be adopting a school. It could be advocating for quality education. Criminal justice, economic empowerment, and education. When we use our influence in whatever space we are in, We are in turn impacting and addressing racism in real and tangible ways. The work of racial reconciliation, it can start with just a conversation, just cultivating a relationship. It's not enough just to cultivate a relationship. That relationship also must lead to me also figuring out, how can I leverage my opportunities? How do I connect with a broader sense to help change some of these issues that have been long-standing? We love others by imitating God in the way that He loves us. And finally, the scriptures say this: love others by completing God's love. Look at verse 11. He says, "Dear friends, since God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. And no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and His love is made complete in us." You know that love is a universal need. Everyone needs love. The young need it, the old need it, the single need it, the married need it, the black, white, brown need it, the rich need it, the poor need it. Everybody needs love. That sounds like a song. Everybody needs love. It's a universal need. We are so wired that we, no matter, even if we say that we don't need it, psychologists and sociologists say that physically our health is impacted when we don't know the nature of true and authentic love. We are designed and wired to need it. And here comes God who has the creator of love, who is the inventor of love. And He gives you this love, and He says, "I want you to go and show that love to someone else." The scriptures, look at what He says. He says, God says, "I'm invisible. People can't see me." God says, "They can't see me, they can't feel me, they can't touch me. I am invisible." But what He does say is that because I'm invisible, when my people show love to other people, then you make an invisible God now visible through your love. You've had that experience where someone said, when you get there, give them a hug for me. And that person's not there, but you go up to the person and you hug them, and you say, "That hug is from Kim. She told me to hug you." I want you to understand that when you became a believer in Jesus Christ, God says, "I want to send you out, and I want you to give a hug to people so that they understand that that hug came from me, that it is an expression of my love when you show love to others." He says to them basically this. He says, "I want you to complete my love." He says, if you experience my love, if you take in my love, but you never pass it on, my love is incomplete. In every sense of the word, He says that love is like a relay race. And God says, "I've already run the first three legs, but now I give it to you for you to finish the race and to take the same love I've shown to you and to show it to someone else." This is the picture of what love looks like. Love truly is the antidote to racism, because love forces you, it pushes you the value of the people. Love gets far beyond our issues and it sees what we have in common, but love is also about action. Love is also about addressing tough issues. Love also is about leveraging whatever I have so that I can honor God and I can address issues that are important. Francis Schaeffer put it this way. He says that love is the final apologetic. It is the defense for which there is no defense. So what will you give your life to? You can give your life to a lot of things. You can give your life to a career. You can give your life to your family. You can give your life to making a name for ourselves. We can give our lives to having nice things and materials. But He comes to us and says that the greatest thing you can ever give your life to is love. A love for God and a love for others. God says if you give your life to that, your life will matter and count far beyond everything else that you could ever imagine. It's the greatest choice we can make. God, make me a loving person. And God, make my love not just a love that just celebrates others, but make it a love that also is willing to get engaged. Make it a love that's willing to enter somebody else's world and see it. Make it a love that allows me to help move things so that things can be in a way that honor you. Let's pray. Father, we come to you today and we are incredibly thankful for this opportunity just to spend some time in your word today. And your word is transformative. Your word is inspiring. Your word is convicting. Your word is exactly what we need. And so, Father, we come to you today, and we just simply ask, God, would you water the word that you placed on our hearts and use it, God, to call us to wherever you want us to be, whether it's cultivating relationships, whether it's getting involved with education or criminal justice, whatever the space you've given us, may we realize that we're not just in that space by coincidence, but that you've placed us in that space because you want to use us, that we are your instrument. Father, in the times in which we live, when there's so much divisiveness, we come today, God, to declare that by your glory, we can be united to do and serve you above everything else. We thank you, Lord. We've got a common heritage, Lord, that we're all from the same spiritual Father. And by that, may we live every day to please you by how we love one another. We thank you and we honor you. It's in your Son, Jesus' name, that we say this prayer. Amen.
Thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. If you would like more information about our church or following Jesus, please go to our website, pcbc.org, or contact our church offices. We hope to see you next week at church.